discuss. So this is the the main kind of core thing, but broadly we'll be discussing management of diabetes in patients with CKD with special reference to oral antidiabetic drugs and with a very special reference to SGLT2 inhibitors, right? So feel free to stop me. This is sort of a broad discussion. We'll start from a lot of things, but mainly practical aspects. And if you have any questions, please feel free to stop me. And for me, it is a chance to learn from you rather than you learn from me as well. So I think it's, cross specialty talks are always something, which I enjoy. So, one of the issues with CKD is that, we know that insulin requirements are pretty erratic. And so there is insulin resistance, which increases in CKD. And then insulin degradation also reduces in advanced CKD. So again, and then typically when patient undergoes dialysis, things again change to a lot of extent. So this is both endogenous as well as exogenous insulin. So there'll be issues at both the places. In fact, we had done a study in Gangaram many years back. We were looking at basal insulin requirements in indoor patients. What we found was that, so we took patients with, we included patients with chronic kidney disease, but we excluded those with eGFR of less than 20 because of, the study protocol. So we found that patients with eGFR of 20 to 45 actually had higher insulin requirement compared to, other patients. And, the reasons where we looked at some of the reasons, but the point being that often forget that, insulin resistance is actually pretty high in this subgroup of patients. So it's a complex matter. Individual patients will require individualized treatment. The other challenges are, of course, HbA1c may be unreliable because of uremia. You have, dextrose in peritoneal fluid. Metabolism of oral drugs is disturbed, and there are changes in dietary intake, exercise patterns, so a lot of life changes also, which kind of contribute to the thing, right? Now, one of the early challenges we always face is monitoring of glycemic control, and HbA1c, though, always has been a standard for care. There are a lot of interferences in HbA1c with CKD. So, you have carbamylated hemoglobin due to high urea, which kind of produces false high HbA1c measures, and then you have iron deficiency anemia, which also contributes to false high values in CKD. This is, of course, for non-CKD patient also, but this, it's common here. And then you have reduced lifespan, hemolysis, RBC transfusions, erythropoietin use, all these can cause false low values of HbA1c. So again, this can, so our interpretation of HbA1c also has to be pretty much in the light of the clinical context of the patient. So, one size fits all cannot be the case in these patients. So then the question is, should you continue to use HbA1c in these patients? Answer is it can be used. So, but what you need to do is you need to see the patient in the individual context, see the, pattern, see what could potentially interfere with the results, and then trace the patient serially rather than just rely on a single report. And what we generally always advise in such patients is to use the same lab, same technique for HbA1c so that, you have whatever, methodological issues are there that are consistently maintained. So it can be still a very useful tool for tracking these patients. Now, another useful test is actually a glycated albumin. And in Gangaram, we in Zydus, we have now a kits available for that. They're not very expensive kits. So, it's on the same platform where you do HbA1c and the other tests also. So it's a simple test. It costs now at, $300, almost similar as, HbA1c. So this is a useful test. And a glycated albumin gives you the, glucose value. So, not the HbA1c, the glycation over a period of 2 weeks, right? So that's the general idea which you get from that. And glycated albumin is a very useful test. What we also use it for, let's say there's somebody who we have admitted, the patient is being discharged. And then, we call the patient back after typically 2 weeks, 1 month, then again, glycated albumin is a good measure to see what's happening at a period of 2 weeks. So it's a, in that sense, a useful test. So I think, we can always talk to, right now, from what I know in Ahmedabad, Zydus is only one who is doing it because we insisted that they do it. But the kit is easily available. The lab needs to kind of be aware that, this is something we can do. Again, you have glucometers which have a issue. So, you have glucometers which use GDH, pH, PQQ methods. And this has kind of, icodextrin and peritoneal fluids and all this, they could have potential, interferences. Another thing, now we use a lot of CGM also nowadays, So you have this FreeStyle Libre. And again, just to kind of point out, we don't have data of use of Libre in CKD patients. That's the problem, right? So we see this being used often, But then there is a tendency to over-report hypoglycemias with these newer devices. So right now, though useful in future, perhaps at this point of time, we need to again take it with a pinch of salt and probably, you know, interpret it in the light of a broad context as a tool to monitor patients serially, rather than to use that as a point of care kind of situation, right? So that's something we always need to kind of look at. Now, if you look at the goals of therapy, well, it doesn't really change whether the patient is having CKD or not, right? The target still grossly remains 7%, as in non-CKD patients. But then patients who have a high risk of hypoglycemia, limited life expectancy, we can consider a more liberal target, right? So again, if you see the thinking of American Diabetes Association changing over a period of the last decade, that what they've started, you know, thinking is more having more liberal targets, having more targets which are individualized rather than to have targets which are fixed for all, right? So let's say there's a patient of mine who has, you know, terminal cancer, right? I mean, the life expectancy is very less. My patient has heart failure. Again, I'm not expecting that the patient is going to live for years and years together. What I'm trying to do is to, for the patient not to have emergency situations in terms of hypoglycemia, neither have hypoglycemic episodes nor have severe hypoglycemia, which would, you know, both the cases would end up in hospitals. So what I'm looking at is a comfortable HbA1c where I can prevent the acute complications, to some extent prevent chronic complications, but at the same time not create new problems. And that's something, you know, which we need to look at. So this is how, you know, broadly speaking now, ADA has now, though the target globally remains 7% HbA1c, the targets can be freely individualized looking at the clinical circumstance of the patient. There are a lot of elderly patients of mine whom we say that, fine, we have reached 7.4. I'm happy with what you have, right? I'm not targeting an HbA1c of less than 7 in your case. I'm happy with a 7.4 for a 75-year-old. I'm okay with that, right? I don't want the patient to develop a hypoglycemia and then fall down, and then patient is already osteoporotic to develop a fracture neck femur and then end up in a hospital and die, right? We don't want that. So that's something, you know, which we really need to look at. So again, in CKD patients, you know, as long as your patient is doing well, young patient, you know, long life expectancy, you know, you can see that patient, perhaps you can do more to help this patient. That liberal, you know, that target can be still tighter, but other cases you can be more liberal. So younger patients without comorbidities close to 7 can be a target, but older patients with comorbidities, risk of hypoglycemia 7.5 to 8% is also a reasonable target. There is now independent data from other organizations have shown that HbA1c of 8% also has good data in terms of microvascular risk reduction. So again, that could be a safe target to consider in patients who are having high risk. So how do you treat a patient? So we'll divide this into patients not on dialysis with CKD and those with dialysis. So we'll look at individual group of drugs, but we'll focus more on SGLT2 because that's the I think SGLT2 is everywhere. Every day I hear something about SGLT2, something new about it's potential to have use in lot of fields. But you know, a lot of thing is hype, a lot of things are reality. We'll dissect out the hype and reality as well. So as far as secretagogues are concerned, glipizides, ripaglinides, we all know this traditionally. The extended release gliclazide is also reasonably safe in CKD patients. So again, I generally discourage use of glimepiride in these patients. And again, if you do use it, make sure that you don't end up, the patient doesn't end up with hypoglycemia. That's the key point. Glimepiride continues to be the most popular antidiabetic drug across the country. Rarely do I see a patient, who has not been initiated on glimepiride at some point of time in their diabetic life, right? But that's something, you really need to. And again, I've seen doses which could be potentially dangerous. You see that this is a ticking time bomb, right? So I don't discourage use of glimepiride, but I think, we need to be prudent of where to use it, but more importantly, where not to use it. Ripaglinide has always been very popular amongst nephrologists. I've always known that, the short-acting drug, secretagogue, doesn't have any major side effects, good postprandial action, good drug to use. What about metformin? Again, a lot of controversies, a lot of things. One thing I'd like to tell you, metformin, a lot of things are, again, because it's been around for so long, a lot of myths get associated with metformin, right? But metformin continues to be the first-line antidiabetic drug in diabetes because of its multiple benefits over a period of time. And, if you're seeing patients for a long time, one thing you realize that long-term stability of a glycemic control is very difficult without metformin in a patient, right? So for every eligible patient for metformin, you should use metformin. That is the general rule, I believe. And one, you know, rule of thumb I'll tell you for metformin, this is what, you know, a simple rule of thumb. You know, if you are in doubt when to use and when not to use metformin, just look at the mechanism of action. So metformin basically acts through the AMP kinase pathway. That's the same pathway through which your exercise system also works, you know. So when you work out, when you exercise, that's again the same pathway that gets activated. So if you see a patient, right, and if you see your patient, if your patient can exercise, a lot of things between metformin and exercise are very similar. So both of them produce a mild weight loss, you know. You know that exercise is not going to cause a major weight loss, neither is metformin, right? It'll cause a reasonable degree of weight loss. Both of them cause a bit of anorexia. Both of them help in long-term glycemic control. Both of them, you know, are reasonably potent, you know, actions as in terms of antidiabetics. Both of them, in terms of side effect, produce lactic acidosis when used in excess. So exercise and metformin are very similar in terms of their action. And if you see which patients you cannot use metformin, if your patient cannot exercise, don't use metformin, right? So let's say my patient is, you know, severe LV dysfunction, heart failure. I'm not going to ask the patient to work out very, again, this is not a patient where I'll, you know, dose them with high dose of metformin, right? My patient is on dialysis. I'm not going to say that, you know, you need to exercise every day. So any patient who can potentially exercise can potentially take metformin. Any patient who cannot exercise, perhaps metformin may not be the best idea, right? So that's a broad sort of spectrum I usually consider. Again, in terms of data, eGFR more than 45, you can safely use it. 30 to 45, you can use the maximum dose of up to 1 gram. And, you know, often, a lot of the times, you know, when you have creatinine high, I calculate the eGFR and write in the bracket that I have prescribed metformin up to 1 gram because it is, you know, eGFR is this much. Because I don't want anybody to, you know, what happens is sometimes, you know, somebody goes, "Acha, tamne to kidney no taklif che, metformin kem aapi," right? That's a common misconception. And again, I think it's a very good drug. In fact, patients with, you know, CKD who have eGFR of 30 to 45 actually will benefit more out of metformin than have any kind of problems, right? Less than 30, you can perhaps consider avoiding metformin in this group of patients. And again, you know, if you have a patient who is hypotensive, who is having shock, hypoxia, you know, radio contrast use, again, this is something which is still, a lot of these are actually in debate, right? And now, after experiencing the havoc of COVID-19, a lot of things are actually being challenged now. They said you could use metformin in multiple of these cases and still, you know, a patient could be fine. Sepsis, you know, so these are conditions where generally at this point of time, medico-legally also not consider using metformin. But other cases, wherever possible, whenever possible, if your patient can take metformin, it is something you should consider giving because of its multiple pleiotropic benefits. And unfortunately, you will not hear too much noise about metformin because nobody is really backing it. Only the organizations continue to call it the first-line drug, which I doubt, you know, in 5 years, nobody's going to, you know, even say that, right? But, you know, we stick by something which has stood the test of time. DPP-4 inhibitors, extremely safe group of drugs, right? You can give it to any patient. There is hardly any patient who there is a contraindication to use of DPP-4, except for, you know, those patients who have, you know, allergic issues with DPP-4 in the past. And patients with pancreatitis in the past, again, this is a group where I'm a little skeptical. We have seen so many cases where potentially DPP-4 inhibitor could have been a potential cause because, you know, whenever you have an acute pancreatitis, it's always very difficult to say what the real reason was. But then we have seen patients where, you know, there could be a potential problem. So again, you know, if you have a past history of such, I think perhaps that you need to, again, weigh your options. But otherwise, in most patients, without major concerns, you can use it. Saxagliptin, anyway, they don't use too much now, but sitagliptin, you require dose adjustment. Linagliptin, always been touted as the nephrologist DPP-4, but the point is that it doesn't require dose adjustment. It's, again, a good drug to use in CKD patients, including patients with end-stage renal disease, safe drug to use, right? Sitagliptin, of course, you'll have to do dose adjustment. So eGFR of 30 to 50, you can use a maximum dose of 50 milligram, less than 30, 25 milligrams. So that's all basically you need to keep in mind. Saxagliptin, like I said, we don't use it much, but less than 50 eGFR, you use 2.5 milligram. What about renal dose adjustment? Again, this is something, you know, I've taken from one of the guidelines, but overall, you know, it's always horses for courses. You know, insulin dose is a very dynamic process, right? You need to, you know, when the patient is extremely glucotoxic, your insulin requirement will be very high. patient is, you know, the glucotoxicity breaks, your insulin requirement can be very low. You can even stop insulin in a lot of these patients. So again, you know, you need to see it with the context of the patient. But broadly speaking, again, EGFR more than 50, there is no dose adjustment required. EGFR of 10 to 50, you can consider 25% dose reduction from what it is, and less than 10%, 50% reduction. But again, I'm saying every patient is different, and I would not generalize this in terms of your diabetic patient you're seeing. Insulin continues to be, again, just like DPP-4 to a lot of extent, but beyond DPP-4 also, it's the safest anti-diabetic drug on this planet and will continue to be, right? At some point of time, no drug can eventually replace insulin, right? The most powerful anti-diabetic agent. And when in doubt, you're not sure what to use, use insulin. That's the safest thing to do. It will help your patients, and, you know, over a long run, you know, you might not go wrong with the use of insulin in a lot of these patients. And you can never be legally sued if you use insulin. That's the, again, the most important thing, right? Guidelines were changed with other drugs, but, you know, insulin, nobody can challenge that, right? Okay. What about patients with CKD on dialysis? Well, again, you know, preferred therapy continues to be insulin. There are certain drugs which you can consider using. DPP-4 inhibitors you can consider using, right? Repuglinide you can consider using. So these drugs you can consider using, but again, your predominant idea should be more or less to keep this patient on insulin. And again, you know, typically you start with a, you know, lower dose, look at hypoglycemia risk in these patients. And, you know, not going to too much of peritoneal dialysis. Glipizide, repuglinide, again, they have mainly hepatic metabolism and they have short half-life, so risk of hypoglycemia is less. So these are safe drugs. And, you know, metformin, obviously, you'll not use in dialysis patients. And insulin can also be given intraperitoneally. I think, you know, I learned this from nephrologists mainly when I was training. So, you know, but subcutaneous is generally preferred, but intraperitoneal insulin is perhaps, you know, sometimes too complex for the patient to adjust. So again, it's a thing. There are issues with that. There is, apparently there's some trials. There's one study which has shown that intraperitoneal insulin was better, but then use is more complex. So again, most of the time, unless the patient wants it, I think most of the time, you know, we are happy with subcutaneous use of insulin. Little bit more on the oral agents now. You know, if you talk about SUs, there are, a lot of them are firmly bound to albumin and hence they're not cleared by the hemodialysis process. So that's again, and again, like I said, I think glimepiride is something I see a lot of misuse of glimepiride. See, it's a very good drug, right? I don't doubt its efficacy as an anti-diabetic drug. What I'm really skeptical about is that two things. One, is your patient the right candidate for use of glimepiride? That's the first thing. Or for older generation SUs, you know, glib and clomide and all that, you know. Secondly, are you giving the right dose for that patient, right? Could you have given something else instead of glimepiride, or instead of increasing the dose of glimepiride, could you have given something else, right? Now, when I see a patient with EGFR of 35, 40, you know, and I see a patient on 4 milligram, 6 milligram, 8 milligrams of glimepiride, it does make me nervous because, for the, you know, life of me, I've seen a lot of these patients end up in emergency with severe hypoglycemia, with prolonged severe hypoglycemia, potentially enough to cause more severe complications. So again, it is, you know, perhaps somebody, if a patient of yours requires 4 milligram or 8 milligram of glimepiride, I think that patient, perhaps you could have reduced glimepiride and given the patient insulin or put him on a basal insulin with other drugs. I think that is what I generally see these patients, you know, over time. So again, not a fan of using glimepiride in risky patients, you know, where you have higher potential of hypoglycemia. I'll tell you another, you know, anecdote. So this one patient, elderly female, right? Not very old anecdotes, I still refresh in my mind. So this is elderly lady who, you know, our hospital's, you know, sister concern, the Zydus Pharma, the finance guy, his mother, right? So this lady lives in Mumbai, elderly lady. She has EGFR of somewhere around 40, right? On treatment for a while, on glimepiride, right? Slightly on the higher dose, dose which makes me uncomfortable. So something close to 4 milligram or something she was taking. Now, she was doing well for a while, right? Her HbA1c was always good. But she comes to Ahmedabad. Her son and, you know, daughter-in-law have gone out for a day. So they are alone. So they come to the house here. The lady develops diarrhea. Right, so this her husband, who is not very familiar with Ahmedabad, she he tries to call his son, but you know, son is not a medical person, so he tries to call her family doctor and something doesn't work out. So they go to the nearby pharmacy. And the pharmacist, as in India, pharmacists are half doctors, so they give, you know, Oflox with, you know, Onidazole, something like that, which is very commonly given by pharmacists. So she takes it. Now, fluoroquinolone is known to produce dysglycemia, right? The patient ends up in emergency with severe hypoglycemia. And like I said, you know, we were discussing before we started, whenever a patient comes in emergency, the neurologist does everything to rule out every other cause. So the patient gets an MRI done, patient gets an EEG done. You know, everything is done. Ultimately, it's, you know, the conclusion is that the patient had SU-induced hypoglycemia. Now, the next patient, where his son, when he came back, he asked me, why would she develop SU-induced hypoglycemia when she never had hypoglycemia and she's been taking this drug for years together, right? Then, you know, we took the history, we, you know, snatched out that there's this, you know, they went to the pharmacist and this fluoroquinolone was given, right? What I'm trying to tell you is that things happen, you know, bad things happen, you never know. Patients, you can never predict what patients will do, right? So patient always on the edge of it will always perhaps, you know, more likely to end up in an emergency situation and create, you know, we could potentially have a problem, right? So I think that is where we need to kind of be more prudent and look at this in a more way, right? So glimepiride is metabolized by the liver, but it has active metabolites which are excreted to the kidney. So hence it is something you need to be careful. Ripaglinide, you know, again, we're not going to too much detail of that. I think, you know, nephrologists are well aware about that. So it's a good drug, short acting. I've never seen anybody patient, you know, I can say hypoglycemia was because of ripaglinide. It's a secretagogue yet. Very short acting. Mainly use it like a short acting insulin, something like that, right? And the dose can be titrated. So you can start with 0.5 milligram, go up to 2 milligram before meals, and generally well tolerated by your patient. So it's a good drug to use. Apparently, we have been using, you know, acarbose also in diabetic CKD patients, and we found it to be very safe, very effective also in this group of patients. Of course, the guidelines are a little bit, you know, they generally don't recommend in patients with creatinine of more than 2. It's still the old criteria. Again, these are drugs where nobody's really backing them, so we don't have new data on AGIs. But again, that is something which we use in practice. Gliptins. Sexagliptin is cleared by dialysis and, you know, must be given after that. And thiazolidinones, again, a lot of misconceptions about it, but generally speaking, nephrologists, I mean, I don't like it, so I don't think nephrologists would like it. No cardiologist, nobody likes it. But it's a drug where, you know, some patients, it's a very good drug, right? Pioglitazone. But again, it can produce edema. And in the era of heart failure, we again, you know, and, you know, there are a lot of studies where now they started doing NT-proBNPs in a lot of these patients, you know, they found pretty high levels in patients on pioglitazone, right, without any, you know, other structural issue. So there are concerns about pioglitazone. Rosiglitazone has always been in controversy. There are concerns about pioglitazone, but till we have any solid evidence either way, in certain group of patients, it's a good drug to use, not in all patients, right? So you have to be selective of where you use pioglitazone. And again, in patients with CKD, I don't think anybody here would probably be using it also. So it's a, and so AGIs generally, like I said, you know, they've not been recommended, but we do use it off-label in certain patients, and we find that it's to be pretty safe. And you know, unfortunately, we don't have any new data on this. I don't think ever a trial is going to be done on voglibose or acarbose in CKD. So we really, you know, whatever small data we have, that's all we have. We need to work with that. You know, okay, and a lot of patients, you know, again, this I'm sure you're well aware, again, CKD patients tend to have minimal symptoms despite being severely hypoglycemic, because, you know, they generally tend to be the vascular effect of diabetes you don't overtly see in these patients, and sometimes that is why you don't see patients often go under the radar, right? Burnt out diabetes, I think, again, this is something you nephrologists see very often. So patient diabetic for a long time, and now, you know, patient is off all medications. That's a burnt out diabetes. It's a interesting phenomena. There are multiple reasons for it, right? Many patients, you know, and with ongoing treatment, they start developing hypoglycemia. So again, reason is not known, but what we now understand is that diabetes can undergo remission. Now, is it because of the weight loss, the nutritional changes which happen after CKD? Is it because of that, or is it because of some other reasons? You know, there are possible theories for that. So again, increased half-life of endogenous insulin, reduced caloric intake, certain uremic toxins tend to have metformin-like effects, you know, so these are all perhaps reasons why you have burnt out diabetes. But again, a phenomena which doesn't have a very clear explanation. but we do see these patients day in, day out, right? Okay, again, this is something, you know, which all of us need to know, and how do you manage hyperglycemia in patients on hemodialysis, right? Again, patients have different insulin sensitivity pre and post dialysis. I think, again, something which nephrologists are very well aware, and again, you need to reduce generally basal insulin by 25% on the day of dialysis compared to before the dialysis. This is of course true for outpatients also. So outpatients on dialysis, on maintenance dialysis, we often give a written instruction of what to do on dialysis day, not on dialysis day. So again, this is something, you know, if they are especially on basal insulin, it's very simple to do that, right? So you tell them that this is what you take on this day and this is what you take on other days once you have titrated the dose sufficiently. And some of these patients we also went on, I was trying to find it, I could not find those exact CGMs, but you put a lot of these patients with CGM also, wanted to actually see what happens on dialysis days in terms of their glycemic control. And there is this whatever phenomena has been described, it's very well seen on CGM also, right? So it's something we see, and that's why, you know, typically we reduce the dose on, you know, following the dialysis day compared to the pre-dialysis day. Now comes the hero of, you know, the topic today, that is use of SGLT2 inhibitors, especially in diabetes per se, but especially with regards to the use of SGLT2 in CKD, both diabetes as well as non-diabetic CKD. We'll see both these things. So what SGLT2 has done is it has now given a common language for three specialties, that is endocrinology, nephrology, and cardiology, right? Now we have one drug which is now common to these three specialties. Right now we have data for all these three specialties individually also and in combination as well, right? And there is now emerging data in other specialties as well, right? So now, you know, if you talk about a hot topic in gastroenterology or hepatology is NASH or NAFLD, right? Again, now there is this data to suggest that SGLT2 inhibitors can have beneficial effect there, right? PCOS in, you know, endocrinology and gynec, you know, that's something which is very common. Now we have data to suggest that SGLT2 inhibitor will be a useful drug in pre-diabetic women with PCOS, right? So it's an interesting drug, interesting class of drug, which has potential to transcend across specialties, right? Drug which I think, you know, unless for you had bold people who really came out and, you know, really did some work on this, I think this would have really been under the radar. Nobody would have, it's a crazy idea to think of this drug at all, right? But it has come and it has, you know, changed the management to a lot of extent, right? So in CKD, heart failure, right, the cardiorenal spectrum, you know, this is something which is a perfect drug to use in this scenario. How does SGLT2 really help, right? So, you know, there's a very interesting paper published a few years back in New England Journal of Medicine where they had given a sort of an editorial where they had given a how SGLT2 really protect the kidney. So we know what happens is that in patients with early CKD, so diabetic patients with early CKD, they tend to have a, you know, there is a hyperfiltration process which happens right now. What happens with SGLT2 is that, you know, this SGLT2 is, there is more induction of SGLT2 when you have hyperglycemia. So one is, of course, the body is trying to conserve the glucose that is lost in urine, but it's also absorbing the sodium, right? And by absorbing the sodium, less sodium goes to the macula densa, and this disturbs the tubuloglomerular feedback, leading to more hyperfiltration, right? So this creates a, you know, renin angiotensin activation. This creates a vicious cycle. Now by giving SGLT2, you're restoring, you're not doing anything, you're not doing the body a favor, you're just restoring the tubuloglomerular feedback. And that is one proposed mechanism by which SGLT2 really works. And to tell you, I think perhaps after ACE inhibitors, I think this is one drug which is really now, even in non-diabetic CKD patients, really shown promise as far as progression of CKD is concerned, right? And I think that is something which is really remarkable. And, you know, that's where I think, you know, we need to see this in as a drug which is not just for diabetic patients, but for its use beyond it. Okay, so, you know, you have, of course, other benefits, right? So weight loss, which is remarkable, right? I mean, in Indian patients, the weight loss we see, yeah.
It has an effect on pressure on the different arteries.
So, what it restores the tubuloglomerular feedback. So, the renin angiotensin system, which was induced, it kind of is restored, right? So, that's what happens. Okay. So, there is significant weight reduction which happens, right? In fact, we have seen weight reduction generally, if you see data, they report weight reduction of 2 to 3 kg in, you know, median weight loss over, you know, all these clinical trials. But we see patients losing 8 kg, 10 kgs, you know, on SGLT2 inhibitors, right? So there is, somehow Indian patients tend to lose more. Blood pressure reduction is also there. Again, very modest in clinical trials, but more significant in Indian patients. You don't develop hypoglycemia per se because of SGLT2, but you have to be very careful if the patient is on insulin or secretagogue. Patient will, the insulin requirement will drastically come down. The SU doses will have to be drastically reduced, otherwise patient will develop hypoglycemia. Cardiovascular benefit, we all have heard a lot about it, right? And we have seen it. We have seen mainly it is driven through the spectrum of heart failure, right? Earlier it was mainly through heart failure with reduced ejection fraction, but now we also see that there is data to suggest that they have benefit in heart failure with preserved ejection fraction, which is a big undiagnosed area in cardiology, which, you know, we don't talk about, we never talked about, because there's nothing to offer to these patients. Now we have something to offer to this patient, and now this is again in vogue. So mainly the benefits are through the structural cardiovascular, you know, the pump mechanism rather than the atherosclerotic mechanism, but that benefit is there, and that benefit is quite robust, and it is seen across the clinical trials, right? So this is something, even there are now, you know, certain newer SGLT2, we did not show overall primary 3-point MACE reduction, but they did show heart failure reduction. So, you know, ortoglyphosin for one, you know, so there are some of these newer drugs, which, you know, some of these drugs, which don't, they're not in too much limelight because the trials were, you know, not as impressive as the ones which are in the market, but they, even those drugs did show reduction in heart failure, right? Hospitalization for heart failure. So it's a good, I think it's a remarkable drug for heart failure, you know, and I think that's something which is here to stay. And cardiologists are, you know, really happy about it. Again, so there are key physiological mechanisms. So on left, you have the benefits as far as the glucose are concerned. So you have HbA1c reduction, which is very, very potent. But then you have breakdown of glucotoxicity, which we have seen in clinical practice. So see, a lot of the times, you know, when we see patients, they are in a glucotoxic state. So what is glucotoxicity? So basically, you know, hyperglycemia begets hyperglycemia. Hyperglycemia produces more hyperglycemic situations. So when you have a patient who is having severe hyperglycemia, remember the beta cells of the pancreas are not only secreting insulin, but they're also sensing glucose. It has a dual mechanism. So this mechanism of sensing glucose is desensitized when you have a patient with severe hyperglycemia. So the insulin which should be released at the level of hyperglycemia is not released. So the patient continues to be hyperglycemic, and yet there is no insulin released to the extent where it should be in this response to this. So when you give this patient insulin, or when you give this patient a potent anti-diabetic drug which can reduce this glucotoxicity, the entire spectrum gets restored, right? So what happens, you know, let's say you have a newly diagnosed, we see patients, newly diagnosed, young patient, 35-year-old patient, this is every day, 35-year-old patient with HP, suddenly comes with an HbA1c of 13, right? 400 sugar, right? And ketones are negative, right? So obese patient, history of weight loss. This type of patient, when you start this patient on insulin and certain other drugs, the insulin requirement, initially it increases, but suddenly it starts reducing. And after a few weeks and months, perhaps they don't require any anti-diabetic drug at all, right? Because what happened was, when the patient came, he was in a glucotoxic spin. And what we did was, we corrected that, we removed that. Now, whatever residual beta cells are there, it kind of, you know, functions back, and it kind of, you know, patient goes into a partial remission state, right? This type of phenomena has been described earlier in you know, African youths, right? So Asian, you know, it was known as flat bush diabetes. But now in India also, we see a lot of these patients, right? And in today's world, very commonly, right? So glucotoxicity is definitely broken down by SGLT2. Also insulin resistance, and this ultimately, you don't have actual beta cell function improving, but you have the pre-existing beta, the existing beta cell kind of tends to function more effectively. Of course, you have body weight reduction, right? On the other hand, you know, as far as it acts as a mild as a diuretic, and it reduces, you know, plasma volume. But the interesting thing, what studies have shown, is that it mainly reduces interstitial fluid without causing an intravascular fluid reduction, which is again something very interesting as a diuretic. It reduces blood pressure and, you know, improves the glomerular hyperfiltration is kind of, you know, curtailed. So again, you know, the nephrology guidelines are now recommending use of SGLT2 early on in diabetic CKD patients. These are the ERA, EDTA guidelines. I'm not going to do details of the guidelines. You know, these are all papers available. ASN guidelines, the only one I'll touch upon is the KDIGO guidelines. And, you know, in short, The guideline recommends that SGLT2 inhibitors should be used in patients with CKD with EGFR more than 30 plus any level of hyperglycemia. So they recommend that SGLT2 should be the part of the treatment, right? Whether you're giving other drugs or not, at least SGLT2 should be considered. And I think this is a very strong position statement, I think. And I think I completely agree with something, you know, you can agree because you have now data to back this, right? And I think, you know, it would be a crime perhaps not to consider SGLT2 in this group of patients, right? We'll of course see where not to use, but as a default, perhaps this drug should be considered in your diabetic kidney disease patients unless proved otherwise. Okay, now one very common thing, and I would really like to have your inputs also in this. So initiation of SGLT2, often you have patients who have transient acute reduction of EGFR, right? This has again been documented. This has been documented in clinical trials. So I'll tell you, Credence study, right, which was canagliflozin study, and the empagliflozin study for again, you know, EMPA-REG trial. Both of them, there were about 20% of patients who had more than 10% acute reduction of EGFR, right? So you do experience that, right? Now, mainly it is a hemodynamic in origin, right? But generally, now what guidelines have suggested that if you have less than 10% reduction of EGFR, there will be transient increase. But if it's, you know, close to 10%, you can continue 10 to 30% can continue using the drug. If it's more than 30% decline in EGFR, perhaps then you need to reevaluate and stop the drug, reevaluate, and then, you know, relook at whether you should continue the SGLT2 as well. But at least, you know, we counsel a patient that this is something you can expect, right? So if the patient is having diabetic kidney disease and patient is put on an SGLT2 inhibitor, the patient will have a transient, change in the EGFR. And that is something, you know, which both the patients as well as the doctors should kind of be in tune with. Just today, there's a patient seen by cardiologist. The patient's baseline creatinine, I don't know, but then patient had a creatinine of 2 when he was seen by the cardiologist. Clearly documented that the patient was on a, SGLT2, and then after that, there is an increase of EGFR, which I feel, you know, is something which should have been anticipated when it was done, right? So again, now patient clearly came and told me that cardiologist said, "Tujhe kya dawa na apda?" Right, because creatinine maru vathi gayu, right? But I think, you know, perhaps we don't know I didn't know the baseline, so I'm not in the position to really comment on whether there was the right thing to do or not. But this is something you can anticipate, right? And over a long time, the benefits of this transient problem, I think the benefits will clearly outweigh the risk. But if you have a patient which is unstable, right, which is the patient is hemodynamically unstable, perhaps a recent surgery, perhaps a recent blood loss, perhaps a recent bout of severe diarrhea, I think this is not the right time to initiate SGLT2. Perhaps in the future, you know, perhaps it would be a good drug, but I think an unstable patient, SGLT2 is not a good drug to use, right, in any circumstance. But a patient who is chronic, stable patient, I think this drug should be considered to be used. So I think this is something, I'd love to have your inputs also. So if you have anything to, you know, please feel free to add, let this be a dialogue rather than just me talking. Okay, so and then there is one very beautiful insight which I would like to give you. So when these drugs came, and you know, when we have discussion, this is something I learned from the discussions with nephrologists, discussion with other specialties. So there's one thing, you know, which often I've seen a lot of doctors, a lot of physicians also say that when the EGFR is less than 45, then SGLT2 you should not use because it's not an effective antidiabetic drug, which is true. But I think we are missing the point. There are two aspects here. Are you using SGLT2 as an antidiabetic, or are you using SGLT2 for its pleiotropic benefit, that is renal protection? Right? Now, these two ideas have to be separated out. Right? This is first thing we need to understand. It's a very good antidiabetic drug, right? But it's effectivity as an antidiabetic drug will progressively decline as the EGFR goes down. This is a fact. I think this fact cannot be changed. But it's also a drug which is a renoprotective agent. Even in non-diabetic patients, now with the DEPA-CKD trial, you have shown that even in non-diabetic patients, this drug is found to be useful, right? So trials including, you know, DEPA and EMPA and Credence, all the three trials have shown that even patients with EGFR as low as 20, you had patients continuing to benefit as far as the kidney renal outcomes are concerned, right? So as an antidiabetic, you will have blunting of its effect as the EGFR goes on. But as a drug which protects the kidney, it continues to have benefit even at an EGFR which is as low right now, as low as 20, as we have seen from clinical trials. And this is one very important insight which, and whenever I, you know, hear this, this is something, you know, it immediately, I think what people mistake is that to consider that the benefit of the kidney really comes from its use as an antidiabetic. No, it has benefits beyond its use as an antidiabetic. It's not, whatever benefit you're seeing, you're not just seeing from the HbA1c reduction. You're seeing it from factors beyond its HbA1c reduction. And that is why this drug is different from all the drugs which have come in the past. That is something which we have to understand. See, even metformin reduces HbA1c, even as, you know, SUs continue to, insulin also reduces HbA1c, right? But all patients with, you know, where HbA1c was significantly reduced, could you prevent microvascular complications in all patients? No, right? So hence there was an area of need to have another drug, and that's where SGLT2 really comes, right? It has renoprotective benefit beyond its use as an antidiabetic. And this is something, you know, which has to be kept in mind. So even though you may feel that as an antidiabetic, it's not a good drug, it's not a very effective drug when the EGFR is lower, as a renoprotective drug, it is still useful. Right, and this is something, you know, which we need to keep in mind when you prescribe this. Second thing is, again, this is, you know, and we, you know, give talks for GLPs also, but there is one very clear difference, right? GLP receptor agonist, the guys, and you'll hear a lot about this now here, because oral semaglutide is just around the corner. It's going to be launched in January. You'll hear so much about it, and ad nauseum, you're going to hear a lot about it, right? So GLPs are back, right? And they're back with a bang, because the company is going to put a lot of resources behind it. It already started. The point is, there is, you know, all these trials, you know, so you had the LEADER trial and all the sustained trials and all that. You had some renal benefits seen with GLP receptor agonists. But there's a key fundamental difference. All these earlier trials, they actually showed that there was, you know, the GLP agonist prevented the progression of microalbuminuria. But they have not done a trial where the hard renal outcomes, that is the progression of the renal failure or the EGFR, actually EGFR progression has not been documented. So whatever GLP receptor agonists have shown, in fact, this same thing was even shown by glycolazide. If you see the earlier trials of glycolazide, right, which was sponsored by Sardia, and they continue to be claimed that we are the first drug actually showed microalbumin reduction. Even with sitagliptin, you know, you had trials which have shown, smaller trials, but they have shown microalbumin reduction. It's not just microalbuminuria reduction. You have actual prevention of progression of kidney disease, which has been documented with recent SGLT2 trials. So I think this is another fundamental difference you need to understand. Are we just using a surrogate marker, or are we seeing actual hard points of renal, renal outcomes? This is where SGLT2 clearly differentiates between the other antidiabetic drugs, right? So again, though GLP receptor agonist, it's an excellent class of drug, very good antidiabetic, cardiovascular protection, but it has a different stream, right? It has mainly effect in terms of atherosclerotic risk reduction. It is that group, right? Whereas this is a group where you have more vascular involvement, you have more of vascular things, and you have more renal protection in an actual renal manner, right? So I think this is another key insight, which, you know, often we see this being discussed, we miss out this key point. So this is something, you know, again, you need to kind of, these are some insights from my end, right? So again, so these are the trials. I think you have all heard about it. I'll not go into too much details, but you had EMPARIC outcome, CANVAS, CREDENCE, which has not been listed here, DECLARE TIMI, and VERTICE CV. So VERTICE CV was the, the one where you did not have a clinical significance. But all these things, you had MACE reduction, you had cardiovascular death reduction and heart failure, hospitalization for heart failure, which was significantly reduced, as you can see, in all these trials. So one thing is clear. Right. If your patient is on SGLT2, patient is less likely to die from a cardiovascular event. That's very clear. And mainly these are driven through heart failure. Right. No matter what they claim, I'm sure, you know, every company which makes SGLT2 also claims that this has benefit in terms of atherosclerotic risk reduction as well. But predominantly the benefit comes from heart failure, and that is something we should always keep in mind. Right. Again, you know, renal outcomes, EMPARIC outcome. Again, all these trials had shown, the doubling of serum creatinine, initiation of renal replacement, death due to renal disease. They've actually taken clinical renal hard points. They've not just shown a surrogate marker, and there was clear benefit there. Same with other trials, CANVAS, DECLARE TIMI, VERTICE, and so on. Right? Okay. Now coming to the DEPA CKD trial, which is the recent trial. This was published in New England Journal of Medicine recently. So this was the trial design. So they used dapagliflozin 10 milligram versus a matching placebo. This trial was stopped early because, you know, the educator found that the benefits were clear, and I think, you know, there's no point of continuing the trial. It was only followed up. The median follow-up was just 2.4 years, which is quite remarkable. I think, you know, that itself is a testimony of the fact that this is quite remarkable data, which is now available to us. It's you know, 21 countries, including many, you know, centers from India. You had, you know, 200 patients from India, which is a great thing, right? 66% patients had type 2 diabetes and 33% were not diabetic. So this was a trial which looked at things more globally. So, you know, again, overall baseline parameters were equally matched in both the groups. And, you know, like I said, about 60-70% had diabetics. The mean eGFR was 43 at the time of, you know, the initiation of the trial. So they looked at these primary outcome. This was the main primary outcome, that is sustained more than 50% eGFR decline, end-stage development of end-stage kidney disease, renal or cardiovascular death. And if you see all these points, you can clearly see, you know, clinical significance there, 39% reduction in the primary outcomes, right? And number needed to treat is 19, which is again pretty good, right? So I think this is something which I think is a perhaps would be considered to be a breakthrough to a lot of extent, because now you have one drug which does show benefit even in non-diabetic patients. Again, secondary outcome, you know, was the individual event thing, and again you had clinical significance there. Cardiovascular death or heart failure hospitalization was again a secondary outcome. Again, you had clinical significance. This was already be shown in earlier trials as well. So I think, you know, this was just an add-on point, and all-cause mortality was also reduced. Clinical significance was there, right? So clearly, there is a lot of benefits to consider over here. Requirement for chronic dialysis, kidney transplant, renal death, again, you know, you had significant. So overall, you know, you can see most of the things, you know, you had, except for individually, if it's just cardiovascular death, there was benefit, but it was did not, you know, the p-value was not clinically significant, but rest of the parameters had, you know, clear benefits, which you could clearly see with 10 milligram of dapagliflozin. So you had patients with diabetes, but without diabetes, as you can see from this data. And again, even in non-diabetic patients, there was 50% reduction of the primary endpoints, right? In fact, perhaps data was better in non-diabetic patients, you know, for clear reasons. Obviously, you know, I was always told when I was learning that diabetic kidney disease is worse than the other, you know, non-diabetic kidney disease. So, you know, there are other comorbidities, other risk factors always into consideration. Right. Even the, you know, the surrogate markers, that is urine albumin creatinine ratio, were also, there was significant difference there. So across the board, I think this now, I think, should be clearly, it's very clear that it has benefit as a renoprotective drug, which without a doubt. And I think this is similar things have been also shown with the other SGLT2s also. So again, this is not just confined to dapagliflozin, though dapagliflozin, the data is pretty robust. What about side effects? Now, there are a couple of things which you need to kind of be aware about. So this is from the study. Volume depletion is something we need to be aware. So again, you know, if a patient is acutely ill, dehydrated, you know, recent surgery, planning for a recent surgery, this is not a drug to use, right? Patient now has a, you know, complicated UTI situation, you know, where the patient has recurrent UTI, patient has a structural problem. I think, again, not a good drug to use in this group of patients. So now, whether a diabetic patient per se develops new onset of UTI, yes, they do. I think it would be sad to say that no, that's not the case, even though, you know, companies may claim that, right? You do see increased risk of urinary tract infections. But again, you need to see the benefit versus risk in your patients, right? Most importantly, and this is no, you know, data has kind of documented this, but except for one Indian study, which actually prominently said this, Indian patients feel a lot of fatigue on initiation of SGLT2. Now, I don't know your experience, but we have seen this since, you know, and we have discussed this across the board with other endocrinology colleagues everywhere. I think this is something which is very, very common. Now, there is no clear reason for it. Perhaps there are central fatigue mechanisms which are in play here. There are theories, again, you know, nothing is substantiated, but patients do feel fatigue, right? Now, what is the reason? We don't know, right? that's one query, one question which is there. And perhaps, you know, again, perhaps it's because of volume depletion or for other reasons, we are not very sure. Other thing, you know, patient, there is also not only loss of fat mass, but there is also muscle mass which is being lost, right? So that is also there. So there's a, you know, as far as nutrition is concerned, you know, there is loss at, you know, all spectrums, right? So again, it would be unfair to say that you're just losing fat, you're also losing muscle mass, right? Perhaps that could be added to that. So perhaps you are nutritionally different from the West. This has never been reported. Fatigue has not been reported as an outcome in any clinical trial, but it is something which our patients come and tell you. And again, reasons are not very clear. On the other hand, heart failure patients, right, tend to actually feel better, right? Now, again, which is again very clear. So because of its, you know, antidiuretic effect or, you know, there is improvement in outcomes in heart failure patients, but your general diabetic patients not having heart failure perhaps do experience a lot of fatigue. So that is, these are some of the common challenges. And again, weight loss is more than what you expect. This is what we learned from clinical practice. Weight loss is more than what you expect from the clinical trial. So you don't see 2 to 3 kg weight loss, you actually see more weight loss, right? And again, something, you know, this is something which your patients need to be told, because like I said, sometimes, you know, very commonly we see patients come to us and say that, you know, I am experiencing unintentional weight loss of 10 kgs, right? And you see that anti-diabetic medications, and you see that SGLT2 had been introduced 4 months back, and kyarthi weight loss tha 4 mahina thi, ab dawai navi dawa kyarthi chalu kari 4 mahina thi, right? And patient gets every single test under the sun done, including endoscopies and PET scans and everything, and there's no cause found, and they come back to us, and then we tell them that this is the reason why you lost weight, and visible weight loss. You actually see the patient look much leaner and thinner, which somehow, unfortunately, in our society is seen in a very negative connotation. This is something, you know, which I experienced the hard way. So this is what happens. But again, you know, clearly, a lot of the patients.
Recently, we have seen that the patients would come up with severe metabolic.
No, so yeah.
Yes.
So again,
was 6.1.
Yeah. So there is a risk of. Without a doubt, you know, you have euglycemic ketoacidosis, which has been reported. We have also seen patients with euglycemic ketosis. The problem is, again, wrong choice of patient to give an SGLT2. This is what happens, right? So if your patient is if you are a patient with clearly having type 1 diabetes and somebody initiates an SGLT2, there are a lot of patients in society whom the actual characterization of the diabetes has never been done, right? Remember, it has always been assumed that children have type 1 and adults have type 2, which is never the case, right? In fact, type 1 diabetes is as common in children as it is in elderly population, right? Extremes, it's an autoimmune disease. Extremes of age, you see that. You also see in younger population also, there are a lot of, you know, there are a lot of patients with LADA who have never been diagnosed as LADA, right? There are a lot of children with type 2 diabetes who have been mislabeled as type 1 diabetes, right? And this is where quacks often take advantage of them, getting insulin chhoda issue, and, you know, they are right often because it was a type 2 diabetes, you know, wrongly labeled. So we see this. The problem is, if you are seeing a patient who is lean, right, who has history of admissions with diabetic ketoacidosis in the past, who is on insulin, right, for a long time, there is no reason to suspect a type 2 diabetes. Perhaps it would be a good idea to first characterize the patient before you start the patient on SGLT2. You know, we have seen very unusual cases of euglycemic ketosis. So it does happen. Again, it would be unfair to say that, no, it doesn't happen. It does happen. Everybody has seen cases of euglycemic ketosis in practice. So if you're seeing an unexplained metabolic acidosis on a patient on SGLT2, which has been recently introduced, and, you know, patient was diabetic on insulin, perhaps again, this is something you should need to consider, because the sugars will be 150, 160, right? But if you see, you know, the metabolic acidosis will be disproportionate to that. So you do see these patients, but I think that is the problem. There is wrong choice of patient, and that's something you again need to be careful. Okay. So these are the things, again, you know, so this is kind of a summary. So you had 39% relative risk reduction of primary endpoints, 44% in the renal composite endpoints, 29% in the cardiovascular endpoints, and 31% reduction in all-cause mortality with the DEPA-CKD trial. Okay.
What happens to glucose in a patient who is non-diabetic CKD?
No, so they don't develop hypoglycemia. If you're, that's the question, no.
See, in this trial,
what you're doing is the renal threshold, right? So the renal threshold for glucose, you're just bringing it down. So they'll continue to, if you do the renal glucose, you will find glucose in urine, right? But they will not develop hypoglycemia, right? So the body compensates for that. So the urine, it's flushed out, but then at the same time,
But this report is being silent about two things. what they have been saying is that there's no sort of hypoglycemia who have been reported, and they don't mention about blood pressure as an outcome.
But I think their primary, I think there is data on blood pressure also, they've not mentioned it. There is data on blood pressure reduction as well, but I think the idea is that this was not mainly a, because they already have another arm of cardiovascular data, they have not given focus to the cardiovascular data. So that's the idea. They already have declared
UTI.
Yeah, they have mentioned UTI. There is UTI. Not in this table, but there are, you know, I mean, this table doesn't have it. There are UTI which has been reported, and without a doubt, UTI is more common, like I said, in these patients.
Amputation risk?
Not in this. So the amputation risk was mainly with one trial with canagliflozin, right? Not been replicated in other trials. Again, exact mechanism, perhaps a rheological system. There is no clear explanation for that. There is also concerns about osteoporosis, which has not been confirmed. But I think it's, you know, you would require a pretty long trial to really prove that any drug produces osteoporosis, right? Unless, you know, mechanistically it does. So these are all, you know, they always mention fracture. But see, again, fracture is an end point of thing, right? And patient might have osteoporosis. Patient never falls and never develops a fracture. That's always happened. So during this 2.5 year period, nobody fell and nobody developed a fracture. That's all it happened, right? So I think these data require a longer, I think more longer studies or perhaps post-hoc analysis to really see this. And I'm sure this will come with SGLT.
We see in our clinical practice many times patient with recurrent heart failure with reduced ejection fraction by 20 to 25% ejection, and most of these patients have the blood pressure around 90,
right?
And the cardiologists are very keen to put them on RNA therapy.
Yes.
At one point of time, they are on RNA, prescribed SGLT.
Also.
And most of the time, this kind of patient will end up with. So what will you do? Like, what will you stop?
Yeah, I think my bias is always to, you know, prefer SGLT2 over RNA, right? But like I said, you know, I'm not a cardiologist. I'll, you know, that decision is of course, I completely agree.
Also.
And not only that, patient will also be on another diuretic also. So there'll be a diuretic, there'll be RNA, there'll be SGLT2. And if you see the guidelines, the thing is that after these two drugs, class of drug, the guidelines have been very aggressive on having RNA and having SGLT2 in most of the patients wherever.
So, like, so if you have to choose, will you choose RAS inhibition
SGLT2
inhibition?
Yeah, so see, we don't have, you know, for whatever we have, we don't have an head-to-head trial between these two classes of drugs, right? Until we have that data, you know, it would be very difficult to put in, you know, one over the other, right? My comfort would always come because, you know, we have used SGLT2 for long time now, right? We know, we understand how it works, we understand the safety. It's a diabetic patient, without a doubt, of the two, if I had to choose, I'll always choose an SGLT2. A non-diabetic patient, I think, you know, then the game is open for the thing. And again, you know, if you talk about RNA also has anti-diabetic properties. So it's, we have, in fact, again, you know, we often now started educating cardiologists that, you know, remember, this has, though mild, there's an anti-diabetic property also. So again, the other drugs we need to kind of adjust, you know, if your patient is on an insulin or, you know, other things. So there is some cross overlap of things. But I think if it's a diabetic patient with heart failure, the benefits which an SGLT2 gives is very, very clear. It's a good anti-diabetic, prevents heart failure, renal protection. Then of the two, if I had to choose, I'll always choose them.
Because like, as a nephrologist, our experience with RAS inhibition is probably
more
century old than SGLT2 inhibition. Probably we have just started using SGLT2 inhibitors. We don't know about long-term experience of. Probably we'll be more comfortable with RAS inhibition because we have used it since.
Even with SGLT2 inhibitors, they are used in patients who are already on RAS blockers.
RAS blocker. So,
yeah.
RAS, so
again,
still,
it
I think
be difficult
no,
what,
no protection.
What to choose and what not to choose.
Because like,
no, but I'll tell you, sir, the trials at least, they, I mean, if these trials, they included patients on RAS inhibitor.
Yeah.
So
this
is this beyond.
The benefits are seen over and above RAS block.
Yeah. It is. So that's what
we need to assess the hydration status. See what happens.
Yeah.
Is many of them are on diuretics.
100%.
We find cardiologists are using diuretic query if the patient may not have edema. If you have somebody who you find doesn't have too much of edema, probably the risk of using these drugs. somebody who is edematous grossly may not probably react adversely. But somebody who is already lost a lot of edema, there is not much of fluid overload, there if you use these drugs, then probably the chances of
But again, in these cases, you know, that the thing which from our whatever bias perspective, we often say that, I mean, why don't you reduce your dose of diuretics? You know, have another drug with another class of action, which has benefits, multiple benefits. So I think, you know, continue SGLT2. If this is the case, continue SGLT2, but reduce the dose of the diuretics you're using. That's how somehow, you know, we need to create a consensus. That this is where, you know, the problem is that somebody wants to start this drug, but then of the three, two don't and one want to, and then there's always this conflict, right? In fact, you know, for the longest time ever, we were always told when we were trained. So I remember canagliflozin actually came when I was already I was a resident, right? So we were always told that in hospital don't start SGLT2. This was a blanket thing, right? But now I see that, you know, when I go to see a diabetic patient in ICCU, the cardiologist has already started an SGLT2, right? Patient is hospitalized, the SGLT2 is already started. Now it's for me to give other antidiabetic. This is what, you know, so.
Many times,
what happens is,
if SGLT2 inhibitor
is not
high, then it
is not done.
The volume status,
And everything else.
The best strategy would be to stop till the AKI recovers and then add.
Probably it is a good idea that we one by one karo, rather than would be exactly.
Yeah. Yeah. So I think I think with improving knowledge and use of the drug, I think we will at some point reach a common ground. But right now, you know, what is happening is at every point, there are people who are eager to start it, right? But then we need to be, again, we need to be careful of where we are starting. So for a drug, for an DPP-4, I generally don't mind. Somebody starts it, fine, you're taking it, take it. Unless there's a gross contraindication. But this is a drug which is where you need to think before you start it. And we need to see which patient to start and which patient not to start, as important as that. So I think, again, this is where, you know, we need to, and there are a lot of patients where we, you know, where you feel this is a perfect candidate for an SGLT2, but we don't give because there's some reason not to give, right? So a lot of times, you know, you have to kind of balance the act, and I think, you know, we need to kind of choose the right patient. And again, you know, with now at least, you know, in my practice, I'm confident to say I know which patient not to start an SGLT2. That is something, you know, you learn, sometimes burning your finger, sometimes, you know, the hard way, but you learn it. You learn that, you know, I don't want to repeat the same mistake we made in a patient earlier. So this patient, I'm going to start an SGLT2, not now, maybe after a while, right? And one such group of patient, you know, a patient with acute hyperglycemia, you know, patient is completely catabolic, losing weight, you know, already polyuria, you give them SGLT2, the patient is miserable, though their blood sugars are better, right? We don't use it. So what we do is we give this patient insulin, we put them on a DPP-4, perhaps metformin, you know, whatever. And then once the patient becomes better, the patient regains some weight, and then, you know, then we're looking at the chronic aspect. Then we switch, you know, stop one of the oral antidiabetic and then switch over to an SGLT2. And then patients do well. So, you know, often we see physicians make this mistake. So, you know, patient is extremely catabolic, and then you add an SGLT2, the patient becomes worse. So patient then comes to say, sir, sugar is better, but I feel terrible. Right now, what do I do? You know, so then you see the prescription, you see that, you know, the culprit is an SGLT2. As soon as you stop an SGLT2, patient feels better. So I think, again, you know, choosing the right drug for the right patient. And then same thing, we reintroduce the drug after a few months once the, you know, beta cell has now kind of come back, your patient has regained weight, patient is eating well, and then you add an SGLT2. Patient actually then does better with that same drug. So
this possibility of fatigue, you see, because of our high temperature, most of the time our patients are on slightly, you know, hypovolemic.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, bar 42, 44 degree, you are already hypovolemic.
So that
probably they will be having volume depletion.
Correct.
That is why they
that is the reason for budding. So that is the most kind of common theory. Why it is there in Indian patients? Why it is there in Indian patients in India rather than Indian patients? I'm sure there'll be Indian patients from the UK or US also recruited, right?
No,
so it's not a yeah.
Be one of the important cause, because many of the patients on diuretic would also report fatigue. It's very common with
diuretic. You find in summer patients who are on diuretic develop creatine rising up, hyponatremia. In winter they are fine with it, in summer they will have complications. So the temperature, tropical climate would influence it.
Any drug drug interaction or a particular drug that you don't want to
as of now, the ones we discuss, diuretics and all, you need to be careful. But clearly, there's no drug-drug interaction with any of these classes. No. So, there's nothing specific. You need to, if the patient, you need to kind of flush out patients who are potentially beta cell depleted, right? These patients you will not use SGLT2. So, unless you are very clear that this patient doesn't have type 1 diabetes. In fact, SGLT2 has role in type 1 diabetes also. It's an upcoming thing, right? There are studies. Right, but again, right patient, right? So we have also used, so there an adult type 1 who is now obese, insulin requirement is very high, started becoming insulin resistant, giving a small dose of SGLT2 gives remarkable results. The patient completely changes. But we never say this to everybody to do this, because then you have indiscriminate use and the patient ends up with serious complications. UTI is very common. Choosing the right patient. So again, if the patient, so in my treatment form, we already, is there a history of UTI? That's something you ask, then you think that whether you should give an SGLT2 or not. Patients actually come, a lot of the times, patient comes to me from a urologist, right? A patient has gone to a urologist. Urologist, patient has recurrent UTI, and urologist diagnoses the patient as having diabetes, right? That patient, I'm going to put an SGLT2, right? Because the already the patient is having an issue. Not only that, even there are a lot of patients who have, troublesome balanitis. They come to you for that. They said that, this is troubling me, right? Now, if I give an SGLT2, patient becomes miserable, right? So you don't give an SGLT2. Even though that patient is obese, patient is, strong family history of cardiovascular disease, you know that this is the right candidate, but you don't give it then. Perhaps once the glycemic control improves, then the risk of developing, vaginal and, balanitis is less. Then, you can reintroduce the drug, perhaps at that later point of time. But now there are, a lot of practices where people give, once a week, a fluconazole. You've seen this practice where we have seen, patients being asked to get circumcision done. Because, our drug to chalu rakho, but you get a circumcision done, right? We have seen this. So, we have seen all kinds of, crazy things. But the point is that I think, choose the right patient. And for the right patient, this is a wonder drug. For the wrong patient, it creates definitely some troublesome issues. Right?
Coming back to this type 1 and type 2 diabetics in that. So, in renal failure, patients with renal failure, we do encounter a lot of metabolic acid also.
Yeah.
So, you recommend that in all patients who come with acidosis, euglycemic, should you do a ketone level?
If a patient has been, so how do you suspect a patient is, how do you suspect
how do
you,
differentiate between
them? So, in some cases it's very clear, right? So the difference is very clear. So, a young chap, has diabetes when the patient was 5-year-old. But adult patients, sometimes the lines get blurred, especially new onset of diabetes, or perhaps the diabetes which was never ever classified, right? Patient was started on insulin, perhaps a premix insulin twice a day, and patient has been on that, HbA1c has always been bad. You never knew whether this patient was type 1 or type 2 or whatever it was. First thing we ask is history of recurrent admissions for diabetic ketoacidosis, right? Even a very well managed, high resource setting type 1 diabetic patients will somewhere end up with diabetic ketoacidosis, somewhere, right? Very rare, whenever I see a patient who's never, let's say I have patient comes and claims to me that I am having type 1 diabetes since I was 25, but I have never been admitted with diabetic ketoacidosis, first thing I say, are you sure it was type 1, right? That's the first question I ask, right? Because invariably they do, right? Invariably they do, and with changing circumstances and you know, quality of insulins and types of insulin and changing of doctors, and you know, they somewhere they'll fall into the crack and have DK. So if they have, you know, recurrent admissions with diabetic ketoacidosis, my automatically I would label this patient as probably type 1 and then not give them an SGLT2, not consider giving them at all. Label it somewhere, you know, if I'm not diagnosed, I'm not sure that it's type 1, I say ketosis prone type, ketosis prone diabetes, where it is labeled as that. For me, that means that, you know, this patient is ketosis prone, so I'm not going to give them, you know, whether the patient has resources to consider evaluating, then yes, but otherwise, if not, at least I know that this is not a patient for SGLT2. Coming to the more subtle variants, there are two things you need to do, right? So one, we need to do something known as a mixed meal stimulation test. And the other thing we need to do is our autoimmune markers. Now for adults, the only autoimmune marker you need to do is GAD antibody, right? So you do a GAD65 antibody. GAD antibody positive, that means it is either type 1 or LADA. So there's some autoimmune form of diabetes. And this patient again is not a candidate for an SGLT2, right? Unless patient is well insulinized and then a later stage. But you do a GAD antibody positive, rule it out. The other thing we do is something known as a mixed meal stimulation. You can do a simple, even a random C-peptide, but again, it will not give you the details. So what we do is we call the patient in a fasting. We do a fasting sample of fasting blood sugar and a C-peptide. Then we give a, there is a specific protein powder which we give, which is, there are specifications for that. So we give that. Our lab does that. So, you know, for us, it is a simple process. After 90 minutes, we recheck the C-peptide and the post-glucose value. Now we have a scoring system. I'll show you if I have that. We have a scoring system and, you know, it's been taken from other things. So it kind of gives us a good idea whether, you know, you. So this is the standard formula, the Sustakal, but we give Ensure Plus because this is not easily available. This is again from, I think it's from Nestle only, but it's not. So we have this scoring system. So we score the C-peptide based on the fasting and the post-stimulation. And based on the score, so the score is more than 5, strongly suggestive of a type 1. 3 to 5, again, we presumably treat this like a type 1 unless proved otherwise. 0 to 3, unlikely to be type 1, but close follow-up is of course required. And 0, it's not type 1, it's type 2, right? So the C-peptide value, so if the fasting is less than 0.24, right? Again, it clearly gets a 5 score and then that's clearly type 1. And post-stimulation less than 0.6 or even a random C-peptide less than 0.6, again, clearly automatically gets a 5 score. That patient is type 1 unless proved otherwise, right? I mean, type 1, but at least the patient is beta cell deplete. So again, this patient might not be a good candidate for an SGLT. So this is how we broadly kind of think. Again, from clinical criteria, you know, there are a lot of clues you get. Family history is generally stronger in type 2, right? Generally, type 1s don't have, there's nobody in the family who has history of diabetes. Again, sudden onset, acute onset of diabetes, admission, the first time they were diagnosed, they were admitted. Such things, you know, again, point more towards the type 1 than type 2. When in doubt, again, you know, even remember type 2 diabetes can also develop ketoacidosis. It's not that they don't, right? So that's again ketosis prone type 2, that can also happen. So again, when in doubt, it's a good idea to consider. Now we do a beta hydroxybutyrate. Now we have this point of care device also, which is reasonably good. So Abbott has a glucometer where you can also check the ketones. So you can always, you know, when in doubt, you do a point of care checking. Strips are also now very easily available. So you can check the ketone and then, you know, just clarify, you know, just to see whether what it is.
What is the role of
it's a so again post-transplant, recent post-transplant on steroids, don't give it. That is what I feel, because there'll be other risk of infection and all that. A long-standing post-transplant patient can be, right? Unless there is, you know, reason not to use it. Other patients on steroids, it's a very good drug. So other patients on steroids, it's an excellent drug to use. It negates the weight gain that you see with steroids. remember, steroids tend to have mainly postprandial hyperglycemia. This is a very good drug for postprandial hyperglycemia because, you know, again, it reduces the renal threshold. So the higher peaks of sugars, they often get blunted. So it's a very good drug. Barring the only fact is that this patient will be a higher risk of infection. That is the only thing. Apart from that, you can use this as a, it's an excellent drug, especially if you're using it for a relatively short period of time. If you're going to use steroids, it's a very good drug. So yes, you can, and should be used.
Right?
In fact, on the contrary, I'll tell you. Very interesting, but there are case reports. You can just, you know, dig this up also. This drug, actually, it has been found to be, SGLT2 has been useful in SIADH. So in fact, it increases the sodium, right? For whatever reason. So it does not produce hyponatremia, that is for sure. It's never been documented in any of these trials. I really don't know the exact mechanism by which it acts in SGLT2, perhaps, you know, the free fluid loss and then, you know, the sodium gets. So that is the theory. Yeah, yeah. So it removes just the free water. Just the free water without, you know, removing the sodium. That is the, you know, but then it's an SGLT2. I don't know how it that also happens. But there are case reports of use of SGLT2 in SIADH where it has been found to be useful. But it does not produce hyponatremia. So we have not seen this producing hyponatremia ever. Neither it has been ever reported in any of these trials, right? I think this is something which would be reported if it is the case.
No, because that sodium glucose could transport anywhere, something like that. That's why you are associating.
I have seen two or three patients of hyponatremia after initial.